When you make a server available to the internet, especially on a shared host, you'll immediately get spammed with automated SSH login requests. You can view these requests on Debian-based servers by grepping for the words invalid user or authentication failure in the /log directory. Debian auth.log files will give you some basic information about the attempted login, such as the time of request, what username they tried, and the IP the request was sent from. A question I've always had is, where do these malicious requests come from? I think a reasonable assumption is that many of these are automated using simple Python scripts, but I want to know how many of them are coming from hacked web servers. The reason I'm interested in attempts coming from web servers is because just about anyone can run an attack from their local machine using Starbucks Wi-Fi. But when these attacks come from shared hosting environments, especially web servers, it indicates a higher level of sophistication of the attacker. It means they had to exploit a web server to proxy their requests without alerting the owner or hosting provider. I recently watched a great Black Hat talk by these guys from the Heroku Abuse Operations Team, and they discussed some of the lengths malicious users would go to just to set up PayPal scams.
Now, after seeing this, we believe that the initial wave of apps was part of some capabilities testing, some real live bad actor DevOps. We suspended the accounts and the actor would pivot, each time trying to minimize their footprint. So the top image in this slide is from an app that packed the Tor and the mining binaries in a zip file, which would then be unzipped with a unique passphrase at the time of deployment. The bottom image is from a later pivot, this time using GPG encrypted payloads with unique names and unique passphrases. So decrypt, unpack, and mine, sending everything through Tor.
So to find just how many of these login attempts were from hacked web servers, I first needed a large data set of IPs. So I wrote a bash script that runs on a cron tab every 3 or so days that backs up all the files that start with auth in my /log directory. After about 3 days, I copied all of these archives to my local machine using rsync and extracted the files, renaming them numerically. Each one of these files contains about 9,000 to 32,000 lines. To make things easier to work with, I appended all the log files to one log file named alllogs, which was about 82,000 lines long. But there wasn't 82,000 unique requests to log in. A lot of these requests are duplicates from the same IP, disconnect messages, and legitimate attempts from me to log in. To begin cleaning this up, I removed all the lines in this file that didn't contain the words invalid user using grep, which took the file size down from 82,000 to around 25,000. I just noticed that doing this also excludes the attempts that correctly guessed my username, but 25,000 requests is a good enough sample size. From this new log file, I wanted only the IP address, so I extracted them to a separate file using grep again, this time with the -o flag, which only returns the text matching the regular expression I have for IP addresses. After this, I was left with a file that has the same amount of lines as the previous one, but with only IP addresses. To remove the duplicates from this file, I used a combination of the sort and unique commands, which took the IP list down from 25,000 to exactly 3,707. The next thing I tried was to associate these IP addresses with domain names. I thought this would be as easy as finding the IP of a website given its domain, which you can do with the Unix dig command. However, finding the domain name of a given IP is a different challenge. This is because, one, most IP addresses are not associated with domain names, and two, domain names are often associated with multiple IP addresses, especially when you start considering load balancing on larger web applications. There's this tool called NSLookup that can be used to give you some more information on a given IP address. Most of the time it won't return a top-level domain, but it will often return information about the hosting provider. Using only the IP of my web server, I'm able to find that it's hosted using Vultr.com. Similar things will appear with DigitalOcean, AWS, Linode, etc. I ran NSLookup on every IP and saved it to a text file. I could use this to report the machines to their hosting providers, but this usually is not worth your time, unless you're losing a bunch of money or something. Now that I had a list of over 3,000 malicious IPs, I needed a way to sort out those running web servers. I thought of running a port scan on each IP, but not only would that take forever, it would probably put me on some other system administrator's malicious IP list. The goal of the port scan would be to find servers with open ports 80 or 443. These are the ports used by HTTP and HTTPS, indicating that the machine was running some sort of web server. But a faster and less intrusive way to check if an IP is running a web server is just to send it an HTTP GET request. If it returns a code 200, it's probably a web server. So I wrote this Python script to do exactly that. It iterates through my text file of IPs and adds the result of a GET request to a database, including the response text if any was returned. To filter out the IPs with web servers, we can run the following SQLite query on the database, which takes our list down to 507 unique IP addresses. Rather than manually look at all 507 of these web servers through a browser, I wrote a script that uses the Selenium web driver to screenshot the default homepage of each IP address. While running this, I found that some of these web servers would redirect me to a real domain name with a URL path. So I added a function that overlays this URL path on the screenshot. Here's a couple screenshots of what I found. Default Nginx and Apache landing pages. These could mean that there was no running web application on that IP, or that the web application just wasn't configured to accept requests for its bare IP address. If I wanted to go a step further, I could have used a tool like Metasploit to crawl for web pages. PHP info pages. These display a bunch of sensitive information about your server to anyone who views the page, not something you want hanging out in the open. Tor exit nodes. These web pages are put up by people who run Tor exit nodes to explain that their web server is routing traffic through the Tor network. WordPress templates. I was somewhat surprised to see a lot of corporate-looking websites from different countries, but upon closer inspection, I found that most of these were default WordPress themes with lorem ipsum text and stock photos, but there were a couple I confirmed were real by finding the social media pages attached to them. Seeing these pages brought me back to my days of slinging overpriced WordPress sites to boomers from my hometown. I would often set up a staging server with a template I intended to use on their website, and then I'd send the IP to my client to show them what it would look like. Odds are I did not secure these sites properly. Pet projects. When learning the basics of web development and deployment, people often deploy their goofy CRUD applications with little regard for security. It's honestly a great way to learn, but I can only wonder how many of these are linked on someone's actual resume. The more concerning stuff. Nextcloud instances. Nextcloud is an open source version of Dropbox for those who don't know. Windows machines with remote desktop possibly enabled, and router admin pages. The weird shit. At least three different anime forums, someone's wedding invitation, and finally, this dashboard. I don't know why you would ever need a dashboard that looks like this, much less one that connects to the internet. The code for this project can be found at the bottom of the blog post linked in the description. If you try it out, let me know what you find. Thanks for watching.